Macmillan Audio presents Fangirl, a novel by Rainbow Rowell. Read for you by Rebecca Lowman and Maxwell Caulfield. With me, Rainbow Rowell. For Jennifer, who always had an extra lightsaber. A letter from the author. That's me, Rainbow. I don't think I've ever enjoyed the writing of a book as much as I did Fangirl. I started it as a NaNoWriMo project back in 2011, reasoning that a single month was an acceptable amount of time to waste or risk on a book that no one might want. My first book, Attachments, had been published earlier that year, and though it wasn't a failure, it wasn't the sort of success that assured future contracts. My second book, Eleanor and Park, had struggled to find a publisher, and a third novel seemed like a very unsafe bet. I had two little kids and a full-time job. It was getting harder to justify all the nights I was spending writing at Starbucks. So I set November 2011 aside, and I told myself that it was okay to squander it, that I could pile up 50,000 words over 30 days and then set the whole thing on fire if I felt like it. No shame, very little harm done. That freed me to write whatever sort of book I wanted, to take risks on an idea that was hard to explain and very complicated to execute, to create characters that I wanted to spend every day with, to fill Fangirl with 1,000 details that felt very self-indulgent at the time. The cardigans and the coffee drinks, all the different kinds of kisses. Fangirl is a relentlessly cozy book. Even though the stakes for Cath are always high, and she's often actively losing something important, I felt cozy writing it. I felt reassured. I kept writing until Cath felt reassured, too. I tore through 60,000 words that November, and then wrote about 50,000 more over the next few months. Fangirl is long for a contemporary book, because I kept writing extra scenes for myself after the main conflicts were resolved. Cath and Levi keep seeing each other and grounding their relationship. Every other character gets to come on stage and say goodbye, even the doubly fictional ones from the world of mages. I wonder sometimes if all of that indulging and reassuring is the reason Fangirl resonated with readers, and why it's become a book people read more than once. Cath is a vulnerable character, and the book takes care of her. If you, the reader, are a vulnerable character, maybe you feel like the book takes care of you, too. It's a pleasure for me to still be talking about Fangirl after all these years. I loved this book so much that I went on to write an entire trilogy about Simon and Baz, Cath's favorite characters. I've also written a short story about Reagan, Cath's roommate. It's called If the Fates Allow, and you can find it in my short story collection, Scattered Showers. And I've worked on a 4-part Fangirl manga adaptation. There are other novels that I'm very proud of that don't bring me the same warm feelings as this one, because writing those books was so soul-scraping. Every day that I worked on Fangirl was me treating myself to something I wanted. If you're someone who has read Fangirl before, thank you for coming back to it. Thank you for being so gracious and affectionate with these characters. I've never had to worry about Levi and Cath. They found a good home with you. And if you're new to Fangirl, I hope you find some joy and comfort here.
Fall semester, 2011.
The Simon Snow series. From Encyclowikia, The People's Encyclopedia. This article is about the children's book series. For other uses, see Simon Snow, Disambiguation. Simon Snow is a series of 7 fantasy books written by English philologist Gemma T. Leslie. The books tell the story of Simon Snow, an 11-year-old orphan from Lancashire, who is recruited to attend the Watford School of Magics to become a magician. As he grows older, Simon joins a group of magicians, the mages, who are fighting the insidious Humdrum, an evil being trying to rid the world of magic. Since the publication of Simon Snow and the Mage's Heir in 2001, the books have been translated into 53 languages and, as of August 2011, have sold more than 380 million copies. Leslie has been criticized for the violence in the series and for creating a hero who is sometimes selfish and bad-tempered. An exorcism scene in the fourth book, Simon Snow and the Selkies 4, triggered boycotts among American Christian groups in 2008. But the books are widely considered modern classics, and in 2010, Time magazine called Simon the greatest children's literary character since Huckleberry Finn. An eighth book, the last in the series, is set to be released May 1st, 2012. Publishing history. Simon Snow and the Mage's Heir, 2001. Simon Snow and the Second Serpent, 2003. Simon Snow and the Third Gate, 2004. Simon Snow and the Selkies 4, 2007. Simon Snow and the Five Blades, 2008. Simon Snow and the Six White Hares, 2009. Simon Snow and the Seventh Oak, 2010. Simon Snow and the Eighth Dance, scheduled to be released May 1st, 2012.
Chapter 1. There was a boy in her room. Cath looked up at the number painted on the door, then down at the room assignment in her hand. Pound Hall, 913. This was definitely room 913, but maybe it wasn't Pound Hall. All these dormitories looked alike, like public housing towers for the elderly. Maybe Cath should try to catch her dad before he brought up the rest of her boxes. "You must be Cather," the boy said, grinning and holding out his hand. "Cath," she said, feeling a panicky jump in her stomach. She ignored his hand. She was holding a box anyway. What did he expect from her? This was a mistake. This had to be a mistake. She knew that Pound was a co-ed dorm. Is there such a thing as co-ed rooms? The boy took the box out of her hands and set it on an empty bed. The bed on the other side of the room was already covered with clothes and boxes. "Do you have more stuff downstairs?" he asked. "We just finished. I think we're going to get a burger now. Do you want to get a burger? Have you been to Pears yet? Burgers the size of your fist." He picked up her arm. She swallowed. "Make a fist," he said. Cath did. "Bigger than your fist," the boy said, dropping her hand and picking up the backpack she'd left outside the door. "Do you have more boxes? You've got to have more boxes. Are you hungry?" He was tall and thin and tan, and he looked like he'd just taken off a stocking cap, dark blonde hair flopping in every direction. Cath looked down at her room assignment again. Was this Reagan? "Reagan," the boy said happily. "Look, your roommate's here." A girl stepped around Cath in the doorway and glanced back coolly. She had smooth auburn hair and an unlit cigarette in her mouth. The boy grabbed it and put it in his own mouth. "Reagan, Cather. Cather, Reagan," he said. "Cath," Cath said. Reagan nodded and fished in her purse for another cigarette. "I took this side," she said, nodding to the pile of boxes on the right side of the room. "But it doesn't matter. If you've got feng shui issues, feel free to move my shit." She turned to the boy. "Ready?" He turned to Cath. "Coming?" Cath shook her head. When the door shut behind them, she sat on the bare mattress that was apparently hers. Feng shui was the least of her issues, and laid her head against the cinder block wall. She just needed to settle her nerves, to take the anxiety she felt like black static behind her eyes and an extra heart in her throat and shove it all back down to her stomach where it belonged, where she could at least tie it into a nice knot and work around it. Her dad and Wren would be up any minute, and Cath didn't want them to know she was about to melt down. If Cath melted down, her dad would melt down. And if either of them melted down, Wren would act like they were doing it on purpose, just to ruin her perfect first day on campus, her beautiful new adventure. "You're going to thank me for this," Wren kept saying. The first time she'd said it was back in June. Cath had already sent in her university housing forms, and of course she'd put Wren down as her roommate. She hadn't thought twice about it. The two of them had shared a room for 18 years. Why stop now? We've shared a room for 18 years, Wren argued. She was sitting at the head of Cath's bed, wearing her infuriating, I'm the mature one face. And it's worked out great, Cath said, waving her arm around their bedroom, at the stacks of books and the Simon Snow posters, at the closet where they shoved all their clothes, not even worrying most of the time what belonged to whom. Cath was sitting at the foot of the bed, trying not to look like the pathetic one who always cries. This is college, Wren persisted. The whole point of college is meeting new people. The whole point of having a twin sister, Cath said, is not having to worry about this sort of thing. Freaky strangers who steal your tampons and smell like salad dressing and take cell phone photos of you while you sleep. Wren sighed. What are you even talking about? Why would anybody smell like salad dressing? Like vinegar, Cath said. Remember when we went on the freshman tour and that one girl's room smelled like Italian dressing? No. Well, it was gross. It's college, Wren said, exasperated, covering her face with her hands. It's supposed to be an adventure. It's already an adventure. Cath crawled up next to her sister and pulled Wren's hands away from her face. The whole prospect is already terrifying. We're supposed to meet new people, Wren repeated. I don't need new people. That just shows how much you need new people. Wren squeezed Cath's hands. Cath, think about it. If we do this together, people will treat us like we're the same person. It'll be 4 years before anyone can even tell us apart. All they have to do is pay attention. Cath touched the scar on Wren's chin, just below her lip. Sledding accident. They were 9, and Wren was on the front of the sled when it hit the tree. Cath had fallen off the back into the snow. You know I'm right, Wren said. Cath shook her head. I don't. Cath, please don't make me do this alone. You're never alone, Wren said, sighing again. That's the whole fucking point of having a twin sister.
This is really nice, their dad said, looking around pound 913 and setting a laundry basket full of shoes and books on Cath's mattress.
It's not nice, Dad, Cath said, standing stiffly by the door. It's like a hospital room, but smaller, and without a TV.
You've got a great view of campus, he said.
Wren wandered over to the window. My room faces a parking lot. How do you know? Cath asked. Google Earth. Wren couldn't wait for all this college stuff to start. She and her roommate, Courtney, had been talking for weeks. Courtney was from Omaha, too. The two of them had already met and gone shopping for dorm room stuff together. Cath had tagged along and tried not to pout while they picked out posters and matching desk lamps. Cath's dad came back from the window and put an arm around her shoulders.
It's gonna be okay, he said.
She nodded. I know.
Okay, he said, clapping. Next stop, Schramm Hall. Second stop, pizza buffet. Third stop, my sad and empty nest.
No pizza, Wren said. Sorry, Dad. Courtney and I are going to the freshman barbecue tonight. She shot her eyes at Cath. Cath should go too.
Yes, pizza, Cath said defiantly. Her dad smiled. Your sister's right, Cath. You should go. Meet new people.
All I'm going to do for the next 9 months is meet new people. Today, I choose pizza buffet. Wren rolled her eyes.
All right, their dad said, patting Cath on the shoulder. Next stop, Schramm Hall. Ladies?
He opened the door. Cath didn't move. You can come back for me after you drop her off, she said, watching her sister. I want to start unpacking. Wren didn't argue, just stepped out into the hall. I'll talk to you tomorrow, she said, not quite turning to look at Cath.
Sure,
Cath said. It did feel good, unpacking, putting sheets on the bed and setting her new, ridiculously expensive textbooks out on the shelves over her new desk. When her dad came back, they walked together to Valentino's. Everyone they saw along the way was about Cath's age. It was creepy. "Why is everybody blonde?" Cath asked. "And why are they all white?" Her dad laughed.
"You're just used to living in the least white neighborhood in Nebraska."
Their house in South Omaha was in a Mexican neighborhood. Cath's was the only white family on the block. "Oh, God," she said. "Do you think this town has a taco truck?"
"I think I saw a Chipotle."
She groaned.
"Come on," he said. "You like Chipotle."
"Not the point." When they got to Valentino's, it was packed with students. A few, like Cath, had come with their parents, but not many. "It's like a science fiction story," she said. "No little kids, nobody over 30. Where are all the old people?" Her dad held up his slice of pizza.
"Soylent Green," Cath laughed. "I'm not old, you know."
He was tapping the table with the two middle fingers of his left hand.
41. The other guys my age at work are just starting to have kids.
"That was good thinking," Cath said, "getting us out of the way early. You can start bringing home chicks now. The coast is clear."
"All my chicks," he said, looking down at his plate. "You guys are the only chicks I'm worried about."
"Ugh, Dad, weird."
"You know what I mean. What's up with you and your sister? You've never fought like this before."
"We're not fighting now," Cath said, taking a bite of bacon cheeseburger pizza. "Oh, geez," she spit it out.
"What's wrong? Did you get an eyelid?"
"No, pickle. It's okay. I just wasn't expecting it."
"You seem like you're fighting," he said.
Cath shrugged. She and Wren weren't even talking much, let alone fighting. "Wren just wants more independence."
"Sounds reasonable," he said.
"Of course it does," Cath thought. "That's Wren's specialty." But she let it drop. She didn't want her dad to worry about this right now. She could tell by the way he kept tapping the table that he was already wearing thin. Way too many normal dad hours in a row. "Tired?" she asked. He smiled at her apologetically and put his hand in his lap.
"Big day. Big, hard day. I mean, I knew it would be."
He raised an eyebrow.
"Both of you. Same day. Whoosh. I still can't believe you're not coming home with me."
"Don't get too comfortable. I'm not sure I can stick this out a whole semester." She was only slightly kidding, and he knew it.
"You'll be fine, Cath."
He put his hand, his less twitchy hand, over hers and squeezed.
"And so will I, you know."
Cath let herself look in his eyes for a moment. He looked tired, and yes, twitchy, but he was holding it together.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.